Good morning, church. My name is Sam, and I'm the children's pastor, and I'm so excited to be here this morning. We're finishing our sermon series, Summer on the Mount, today, and I have the privilege of sharing today's text with you. Now, when I'm teaching down in the kids' space, I like to help the kids picture what's happening in Scripture. So if you would with me, picture Jesus standing on the mountain. Now, not on the very top of the mountain, but just up enough so the people around that he's preaching to can see and hear him. And as he's preaching, he says, "If you listen to my teachings and follow them, you are wise. But if you listen to my teachings and don't follow them, you are not wise." Now, to help you visualize that, I have some helpers this morning. Now, when Jesus was wrapping up this sermon series, because he's teaching all these lessons, he likes to tell a story. Now, the stories are called parables, and in the parables, they teach us a lesson. And so, here was the parable that he told. There once were two builders. A wise builder and a foolish builder. The wise builder searched for a place where she can build her home, and she found a nice, good rock foundation where she built her house. Whereas the foolish builder, he probably didn't search for very long and found some soft ground, which was sand, and that's where he built his house. And so they're building their houses, and they're constructing them. They're spending a good amount of time. The wise builder making sure everything is just perfect. Houses are built. All seemed okay. They get inside their homes. They get inside their homes where it is nice and cozy. All seems okay. But then a storm comes. The rain comes crashing down. The lightning thunders. The wind whirls and beats up against the houses. And the foolish builder's home crumbles to the ground. But the wise builder's home stands strong. You see, Jesus said, if you listen to my words and you follow them, you are like a wise builder who built their house on a rock foundation. What kind of builder are you? A foolish or a wise builder?
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jonathan Meyer, and I'm going into ninth grade. When I went to CRY Move, I was challenged to take time to pause and talk to God several times a day. Doing this helped me to feel more at peace and less worried about what I would do next. I took a class there about different ways to start healthy rhythms. When I heard about the Rhythms Challenge to continue spending time with God after CIY, I wanted to join. Rhythms is a 21-day challenge that helps you take time to rest spiritually and focus on what is important, spending time with God. Rhythms has daily challenges and weekly challenges. For the daily challenges, there is 3 kneeling prayers, morning, evening, and night, a 21-minute walk, and there's also time spent reading your Bible and journaling. Each week has different challenges, like doing a service for someone else or spending time with family. The challenge also was done with others so that we could check in with each other and pray for one another. It was an incredible experience.
Buenos dias for our Spanish-speaking friends, bonjour for our Haitian friends and family, and ekaro for our Nigerian friends, and good morning for the rest from the Midwest. My name is Ruben, and I'll be going to my freshman year of high school this year. The biggest impact on rhythms for me is that I realized how much time I've been spending with God versus how much time I was spending on time-wasting things like scrolling through my phone or playing video games. Rhythms has really got me closer back to God. And now every morning, as soon as I wake up, I read Psalm 23 and do a kneeling prayer at my bedside. Rhythms has truly been a life-changing experience.
Microphone is on my face and the pack is on now. I love Next Gen Sunday. This is perfect. It really is. I love that we've been able to see students and teenagers involved in every aspect of the service. In fact, I know you've seen a lot of students on the platform, but we've also got students filling the AV booth. The video you just saw a few minutes ago was made by Sadie, who's one of our high schoolers. So they put a lot of time in. You give them a big round. Yeah. Yeah. And if we haven't had a chance to meet, my name is Ben Lakin, and I'm the next gen pastor at Ben Davis Christian Church. I was a little nervous that I would say the wrong thing, to be honest. I've been the worship pastor for 9 years. So this is a new endeavor for me and my family. We're going to get to serve alongside each other. I've got 3 kids who are coming up into Next Gen, and so we're really excited about that. Right before the pandemic hit, a friend of mine reached out because he was starting a nutrition program. He was going to lead it, and he wanted to know if I was interested. I had just had a biometric screening, and my doctor said, yes, you are. I was in my late 30s and like a heart attack risk. So I jump in and we measured nutrition, of course, but also sleep habits and step counts and that kind of stuff. After 6 months, I had lost 50 pounds. And when I went to my next biometric screening, obviously my doctor's like, everything, all the numbers that they're measuring were in a good place. The thing is, I had a coach who had wise knowledge that he was willing to share with me, and I was able to follow what he had for me to do, and that's how I arrived there. Fast forward to now, believe it or not, I've been able to find a few of those pounds that I lost. Yeah, thank you. Way to go. The thing is, I know what the program would have me do, but I'm not doing what I know I should be doing, right? How many of you guys have been there in different areas of your life? You know what you should do, right? Knowledge is not the issue. It's the follow through, right? You know what you should do. Knowledge is not the issue. It's the follow through. Pastor Sam and her crew did a fantastic job introducing today's text, looking at this very last piece of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus says, anyone who listens to my teaching and follows it is wise, like a person who builds a house on solid rock. Though the rains come in torrents and the floodwaters rise and the winds beat against the house, it will not collapse because it's built on bedrock. But if anyone hears my teaching and disobeys it, they are foolish, like a person who builds on sand. When the rains and floods come and the winds beat against it, it will collapse with a mighty crash. I want to break this down in two ways for you this morning. Where can you see this in Next Gen ministry? And what does this mean for you? What this means for you. Today you've heard from 8 different voices on this platform what it looks like to build a firm foundation in Next Gen ministry. Students have shared about connection, serving, invitation, walking together with other believers. And you've heard leaders and parents share why they do what they do and also why they bring their family to Next Gen. Let me debunk one barrier for people that might be hesitant about serving with our next generation, okay? You do not have to be a 25-year-old social media influencer to be effective with Next Gen ministry, okay? David Cooper's 60-something, and he's gonna be baptizing a junior in high school, the second service, right? Bob Fishburne's like 90. At least he knows how to turn his mic on. Yeah, you do. So yeah, no matter where you're coming from, if you have an interest in serving our Next Gen, I would ask that you please find Pastor Sam or find myself and ask, hey, how can I help? You know, we will find a place where you can support this ministry and you can be involved. Also, for your children, okay? Your child, and I don't mean this because they are your child, and I don't mean this because they are a child even. It's because they are human. Because your child is a human, they are going to struggle to build a firm foundation if they are not connected to a group of other children and students and connected to other leaders who can guide them. That's all of us, okay? And so I believe in Next Gen ministry. So I want just to make this ask for you guys. If you have a child in elementary school or middle school, please, please, please bring them on Sunday mornings. We have programming for them at 9:30 and 11, top-notch programming, okay? And they are gonna grow, they're gonna have fun, they're probably gonna ask you to bring them back, okay? If you have a teenager in high school Sunday nights kick off next Sunday, August 4th. Encourage your teenager to come, trick them. Say you're gonna take them to Topgolf, just drop them off. Maybe don't do that. But I really do, I believe in Next Gen ministry. I'm a product of Next Gen ministry. I grew up, my dad was a youth pastor. I know how it can shape you and form you. I'm blessed as a dad to have leaders and coaches and pastors in Next Gen ministry who are shaping them and loving them. And I want that for you too. But we can't do it if they're not here, okay? Now let's talk about you. I don't mind blaming things on social media when I have the opportunity to do that, but not everything that we struggle with or get wrong as a people can really be blamed on social media because some of those problems go back further. And I think one of those things is the notion that if I agree with something, then I've done my part. Maybe it comes from the privilege that we have to cast a vote, right? I voted for this to be done. I said what I believe, so I've done my part. I have a friend in public office who would be quick to tell you that casting your vote is not the complete effort in making a difference. They're always looking for people who are willing to do something. And isn't that what Jesus said here? Did Jesus say, if you hear my teaching and you disagree, well, you're foolish. Or if you listen to my teaching and you agree with it, then you're wise. No. That's not what he said. You could make an argument that there's a difference between listening and hearing. You can hear what I'm saying and not really listen to it. But Jesus goes even further than that. If you listen to my teaching and follow it, you are wise. And follow it and do it. But if you hear my teaching and you don't obey it, you don't put it into practice, you don't put it to work, if you don't do it, then you're foolish. That's what Jesus said. The book of James says it this way, James 1:22. Don't just listen to God's word. Do what it says. Otherwise, you're fooling yourselves. Or maybe you're only fooling yourselves. I like that Jesus and James both use this word fooling, foolish. The question is, who are you fooling? Not anybody else. And why is that? Because no one else can see what you believe. Nobody else can see what you think or what you agree with. The only thing that others can see is what you do. So if you just hear it, you can agree with it all you want. But if you don't do it, no one else can see it. You're only fooling yourself. So when we hear Jesus teaching and don't obey or do what it says, we are in fact fooling ourselves. One of my proudest moments in preparation for today is that the students who shared on the platform portions of their testimony, they wrote what they would say themselves. Maybe you didn't notice, but in case, or maybe you did notice, in case you didn't, I want to point out one thing. Everything that was shared up here was something they are doing or have done or was done for them. Not one testimony from this platform was, I believe this, or I think that, or I've learned this other thing. Everything that was shared was, I'm doing this, or I've done this, or this was done for me. Which means they are taking what they're learning and they're putting it into action. They are listening and following. So where do we go from here? If you're new to BDCC, now I've jumped ahead. I scrolled too much. If you've been around this summer, you've heard a lot of Jesus teaching because this whole summer, the last 2 months straight, every sermon is based on the Sermon on the Mount. Every sermon is based on something that Jesus taught. So you've heard about forgiving others. You've heard about tithing and giving back to God. You've heard about giving God your worry. You've heard about fasting and praying. You've heard about loving others the way Christ loves you. You've learned about shining your light and sharing the gospel. If you listen to my teaching and follow it, you are wise. I know, I'm guessing I'm not the only one who has sat and heard this teaching and thought at some point this summer, man, I need to be doing that. Oh man, I've known that for a long time. I need to start doing it. I know I'm not the only one who's felt that way this summer, okay? If you listen to my teaching and follow it, you are wise. And follow it. The beauty of the gospel of Jesus Christ is he's making us new. He doesn't want us, he gives us a way not to just stay foolish, right? But to become wise. Luke 40 says this, students are not greater than their teacher, but the student who is fully trained can become like will become like the teacher. If we submit to Jesus' will and his way, he will take us from foolishness to wisdom. As we attempt to do what Jesus says, he will make us more like himself. So ask him today to show you what is next. Listen and do it. Here's the part I skipped to. If you are new, I can encourage you with this. Even today, Jesus has a next step for you. Jesus' message is simple and clear. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, and you'll find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So even if you're new, even if you haven't been around for long, Jesus is calling you right where you are. If you haven't accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, don't wait. Let these guys be an example, an inspiration for you to see these brothers taking that step in their journey. If you want to talk about following Jesus or being baptized, I invite you to find any of our pastors. Find Ryan or Josue or myself or Sam. We would love to talk with you about what those next steps look like. Let us all be doers of the word, because knowledge is not the issue. It's the follow through, right? We know what we should do. Knowledge is not the issue. It's the follow through. As our worship leaders come back out, they're going to lead us in the song Firm Foundation. And as we sing, I want you to be mindful of the fact that Christ as your firm foundation, according to what he said in Matthew 7, means that you are doing what you've heard Jesus say through the resurrection power of the Holy Spirit living inside of you. That's our firm foundation. So would you guys stand? I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to sing together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word, and God, thank you for Next Gen. Thank you for these young people who are not waiting to lead, but are leading even now. God, we thank you that Jesus didn't just say things, but that he followed through, and he did, so that we can see his life, we can be shaped by the way he lived his life. We have an example to follow in our perfect personal Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. As we sing, Lord, we ask that you would move in us, that you would bring to mind that thing that we need to change, that thing we need to step into, and that we would trust that as we step out, Lord, that you would make the ground underneath our feet solid, that you would guide our way, you'd be a light for our path. We know, Lord, that you are walking with us, walking ahead of us, beside us, and behind us. It's in Jesus' name that we pray these things. Amen.